Good morning.
Soto United Methodist Church. If you're worshiping with us for the first time, I would like to invite you to fill out the guest card. It's located on the back of each pew and place it in the offering basket after the message. Through this service, we will praise God. We will pray to God together. Read the scripture during the children's message. Listen to the message, give our offerings and tithes, and share good news. Pastor.
Thank you, Jen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Soto United Methodist Church. On the fourth Sunday in Lent, Lent is the 40 days before Easter. The Christians gather together to be more holy and come closer to God. So we are in the fourth Sunday during this Lent. So please turn to your neighbor, say, I'm so glad you're here. Best church in history, right? With the best people around you. So, yeah, amen. Now, Jim will lead us to confess our faith in the Apostles' Creed.
In unison, I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated on the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We sing together Jesus' name above all names.
We're going to listen one time and then sing twice. So, Jim will lead us to pray.
As we read together the prayer of the people, loving God,
Thank you for watching over us every day.
You know everything about us, shame and glory, suffering and honor, and laughter and tears.
Allow us to come to you as we are. Give us humble mind so we can kneel down before you. Let us fully trust you so we can lay down our burdens beneath the cross of Jesus. Remind us of your love. Assure us of your power. Hold us tight in your arms. In the name of Jesus, who knows our suffering, we pray. Amen.
Lord, quench our thirst physically and spiritually. Lord, people in Gaza are suffering so much. Please bring the reconciliation as soon as possible. Fill their needs. Lord, watch over this country. Guide us to the best way. Give people in authority with God-fearing heart. We also pray for those whose names are on our prayer list, those in our thoughts, and those we are not aware of. Heal those in the hospital bed. Strengthen those who will have surgery. Restore their health. Watch over those who have suffered from mental illnesses. Open doors for those who are starting new beginnings. Guide our future generations. And thank you for our loving community. Make this town more beautiful and safer. Open our hearts to our new neighbors to welcome them with open arms. Send us to our family, friends, and neighbors as your hands and feet for changing lives, transforming communities by reaching, welcoming, and engaging. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, the light of the world, and who taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us praise our Lord through hymn number 301. Jesus, keep me near the cross.
Love and mercy found me.
28. After this, knowing that everything was already completed, in order to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Did you hear what Jesus said?
He's thirsty.
I am thirsty, right? I am thirsty. Have you ever been thirsty before? Yes, we get thirsty, right? Do you get hungry? Yes, we get hungry. Do you get angry? Hangry? Angry? Yes. Are you tired? You ever get tired? Yeah? Yeah, me too. This remind, this just this short little statement from Jesus, I am thirsty, it reminds me that Jesus, He is fully human. He came as a baby, just like we were babies. He had to learn how to walk and talk and learn how to eat. He had to learn how to read. And he had to learn how to follow his parents' instructions, right? And grow up. Maybe you have growing pains. Jesus experienced everything that it is to be a human being, right? And we sang those words. We sing them at Christmas. We sang them this morning. Emmanuel, God with us. So Jesus is fully divine, fully God, but also fully human. He understood everything that it is to be a human being. So anytime we might feel that way when we raise our hand at the beginning, nobody knows how I feel. We can remember. Who knows how we feel? Jesus knows how we feel, right? We are never alone. We are never alone because God is with us and Jesus fully understands us. Amen, friends?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, let's give a prayer of thanks for that, and then we will sing our song this morning. Let us pray. Will you pray? I'll pray a line, and you pray after me. Here we go. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
God with us.
God with us.
Thank you for knowing me.
Thank you for knowing me.
And loving me.
And loving me.
Always and forever.
Always and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right. Let's sing our song.
Singing the special music, and he said, "Jeremy, why don't we come on March 10th because it's daylight savings weekend?" And it looks like everybody set their own clocks.
You know, that hit me this morning. You know, I had my phone set up for my pills, and it went off at 6 o'clock. I looked at my clock, and it said 5:00.
My latest song is singing. Thank you.
again, Jeremy. Jesus was crucified on the cross, and then only seven words are written in the four Gospels. We don't know how many words Jesus said, but only seven words are written in the four Gospels. And then among them, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do," was considered the first word of his. And then, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Then Jesus said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." Then in his anguish, he cried out, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then he says, "I am thirsty." Then it is finished. "Then, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." So today is the fifth session of the seven words of Jesus on the cross during Lent. We will share about the word of anguish today. Let us pray. Almighty God, we need you. Thank you for gathering us here to worship you. Lord, open our hearts and minds so we all can understand your will. Please help us to listen to your voice so that we can live our lives as your faithful disciples. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Well, does it make you thirsty? I know, right? Have you had a excuse me? Have you had a thirst? Have you felt thirsty so much? Have you felt your throat is burning and then you have to put some water into your throat? And you want to pour a whole gallon of water into your mouth. Sometimes we feel that, right? We are maybe after exercise or walking under the heat, sun. Yeah, we experienced our thirst, but can you imagine burning throat of Jesus on the cross? Because he shed all the blood, and then he couldn't even move, stuck in the wood. And then in that pain, he was there about 6 hours. He couldn't even move. As death was approaching, he said, "I am thirsty. I am thirsty." And Jesus was fully divine and fully human. And in this particular word of his shows us he was fully human being. Among seven words of Jesus on the cross, this is the only utterance about a desperate physical need of Jesus. All other six words are not about his physical pain. But Jesus did not say "ouch" or "oh" or things like that in the Bible. But the only words of expression of his physical suffering on the cross was written is, "I am thirsty. I am thirsty." The crucifixion was a horrible human invention. We know people invented so many horrible things, but especially this crucifixion was designed to kill a person slowly and most painfully. The significant amount of loss of blood and body fluids caused extreme thirst, and then they died. They were dying slowly, slowly, in extreme pain. Yes, Jesus was fully human being, and we call it in a difficult term, incarnation, which means God became human being. And then Apostle Paul puts it like this: without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. It is the miracle, it's a miracle that God became human being. And he who caused the water from the rock and quenched the thirst of the Israelites in the wilderness, who created waterfall and then river stream, and but Jesus never performed the miracle for his own benefit or comfort. And the God who created all the water and springs cries for thirst with parched lips right now on the cross. This is the one who is dying of a terrible thirst on the cross for the love of sinners and the lost sheep like you and me. He was on the cross for us. Now the thirst shows our basic human needs and suffering. And it's about our unmet, it's not about our unmet luxury, desire, or pleasure. You know, food to eat, clean water to drink, clothes that cover our body from heat or cold or shame, and shelters to protect us from danger. Anybody in this room doesn't have any of this? Maybe all of you had these basic needs right now. It's not about a better car, bigger house, or higher authority, or bigger diamond. Okay, this thirst is basic human need. And as we live our lives, mortal being, we experience thirst, suffering, and pain. Physically and mentally and emotionally, in many ways, we experience thirst. Jesus knows what the pain is, what the unmet basic needs is. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. So Jesus experienced all kinds of pain and suffering emotionally and physically. So the Bible says he can be empathetic with us. He knows our pain. Sometimes we feel God is too far away. We doubt if God is with us. But we can rely on Jesus because he experienced all kinds of things. And this morning, today, we had a first prayer and praise gathering this morning, and our messenger, Avery, delivered, we can cast our anxiety and worries through prayer, petition, and praise. Yeah, that's amen. Yeah, we have our own suffering and concerns and worries, and then we all had sleepless nights, all kinds of suffering. But we know Jesus can be empathetic with us. He knows our pain, so we can rely on him. And on Golgotha, probably before they crucified him, they offered wine mixed with gall to drink. The Matthew's Gospel says, there they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. The scholars say that it was a bitter, and it was given to those who crucified to speedify the senses, because the pain was extreme. So it was kind of dully, you know, so reduce the pain as they are crucified. But after tasted it, Jesus refused to drink it. Because Jesus came to Golgotha to be crucified to suffer, not reducing his suffering. So he refused to drink it. Jesus chose to drink the cup of suffering that his Father gave him. Now on the cross, right before he died, he said, I thirst. So he endured a whole 6 hours on the cross, and then he was about to die. Then he said, I thirst. Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. And he knew all things prophesied in the scripture about Messiah, about Jesus, was fulfilled. So he said, I thirst. Now, there was a vessel full of sour wine or wine vinegar, depends on which version of scripture you read. Sour wine or wine vinegar that was ready to quench the thirst of those crucified. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." But Matthew wrote a little bit more in detail about it. He says, immediately, one of the soldiers ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. We don't know who he was, but one of the soldiers, he immediately stood up and then got sponge and then soaked it and then put it in Jesus' mouth to drink. He filled it for thirsty Jesus. In chapter 25 of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus told a parable of the sheep and goat. In this parable, he said to those on the right side, "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat, and I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." And this one of the soldiers, literally, he gave him, Jesus, something to drink when he was so thirsty. And Jesus continued in this parable, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." Even though we cannot give something to drink to Jesus directly now, we have our neighbors and we need our help and support. That's why we are collecting loads of love collection outside in Narthex in the big basket, and it was filled immediately. I was so amazed. And it is for the Starside Elementary and Lexington Trail Middle School students. And that's why we hosted the presentation of the Care Portal last Sunday to help our neighbors in need. And I'm so proud of you, our church, that you've done so many things for the neighbors, our neighbors in need. That was certainly giving Jesus something to drink. So look around. We will find Jesus who need our hands. Yes, we experience thirst in the world. Even though we can thirst in our mortal body, our spirit can be thirst-free because Jesus can give us the living water in our hearts. Now, physical thirst can be quenched by water, but spiritual thirst is more serious thing. Jesus told the woman at the well in Samaria, he said, "If you recognize God's gift and who is saying to you, 'Give me something, some water to drink,' you would be asking him and he would give you living water." How? How can it be happening? Living water, welling up inside of us. Never we feel thirst spiritually. How? And he says, whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Then Jesus declared, whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. From time to time, we experience thirst, our spiritual thirst, mental breakdown, or we eager something to fill our needs spiritually. What is the living water, by the way? And Jesus says, by this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. By the power of the Holy Spirit, through your faith, we can get through our tough life, and then we can be filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, one of you told me about his story. We know a few years ago we had a tornado in Barnes Springs. Anybody saw that? Yeah. And that destroyed the whole house, one of our church members. And then he said he and his wife was downstairs. Now he felt all the powerful wind shaking. The whole house was shaking. And they were hiding in the basement. And he said, I was not afraid. I don't know why, but I was not afraid. And he said, I was ready. If God calls me, I was ready to go. If he doesn't call me yet, maybe something, there was a reason. But for some reason, he remained in calm peace. I'm not sure I can do that. If the tornado hits the parsonage and then I'm downstairs, maybe I will be trembling. But this member of our church said, I was not afraid. I don't know why. I believe inside of him, the Holy Spirit residing in him and gave him peace. Even though he was in danger, a dangerous situation, he could remain in peace under the tornado. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. Yes, thanks to the Holy Spirit, we can cast our anxiety and worries, away. Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Even though we thirst now, we can have the living water within us that the world cannot make us thirsty. And eventually, one day when we will be in glory, when Jesus comes back, there will be no thirst. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, there will be no thirst, because God promised they won't hungry, they won't hunger or thirst anymore. No sun or scorching heat will beat down on them, because the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them. He will lead them to the springs of the life-giving water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. That is hope. That is the hope that we have. That is the hope that we all are sharing, because we believe in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we heard Jesus say, I thirst. That reminds us of so many things. His incarnation, the miracle of incarnation, that you became human being and you are empathetic with all kinds of pains. Now we rely on you, as you promised. Please give us living water inside of us through the Holy Spirit, so that we can make through in our mortal body, so that we can become your proud children altogether. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Let us give our gift to the Lord.
please stand as you're able, face the cross as we sing the doxology.
Let us pray. Holy God, with humility, we offer our tithes and offerings to you. May they be used to faithfully serve the mission and ministry of our church. Bless those who offer to you with gratitude. Fill their needs. Watch over their path every day. Quench their thirst. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
We have a number of announcements on the back of our bulletin. I invite you to read through those as to know what is going on at our church. This next week and following, one of the things that I'd like to bring to your attention is that we do have United Methodist Men Breakfast Fellowship on Saturday. And we're also discussing the book, Yes, Lord, I Have Sinned, But I Have Excellent Excuses. So it can be humorous, but it is also soul-searching, and we enjoy going through this and giving our own thoughts on these chapters. Any other comments about announcements that need to be made? If not, okay. Pastor.
Thank you. Well, can we have birthday boys and girls? Would you please stand? Nobody? Oh, okay. Michael, please. You're not the only one. Yesterday, Shirley Thomas had a 95th birthday. And then two of the members of our team, Emmaus, came and visited her. Okay, so thank you so much for visiting her. Okay, so 95th birthday. She doesn't look like that, right? Yeah, she is so sharp. And then, yeah. So that girl, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Yeah. 95th and then 35. Thank you so much. Okay. Okay. Last Sunday, as you know, Jennifer Kindler, Gil and Linda's daughter, and grew up in our church. She was here in youth group, right? Yeah, yeah. And then came to introduce the care portal, the practical way to help families in need last Sunday, and then after service. So let us pray how God will lead us to help our neighbors in this matter. And then this morning we had we gathered for the first time, praise and prayer gathering this morning, and we sang contemporary praise music, and then Avery Noble shared the message and prayed together. It finished earlier than we expected, right? Yeah. So it's every second and fourth Sundays of the month, planned and led by youth, but it is open to everybody. So you're welcome to come join us. Okay. Let us praise our Lord through hymn number 504. If you're able, please stand.
On a hill far away stood an old weeping cross.
As you are going forth holding this amazing goodness of Jesus Christ, may Jesus' amazing grace and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit empower you and be with you all forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace, my brothers and sisters.